Cooper.
And I'm Patrick.
And we're your hosts.
Welcome to the first video of LTV for 2022.
In our first segment, we're going to be having a look at our beach program and some of the reasons why it's so important.
We're going to have a talk with some other students about their experiences and what they learned about the day.
Check it out. Can you tell me about what you did on Monday?
On Monday, we played games and learned about beach safety.
What games did you play while at the beach?
We played flags, boogie boarding, soccer and cricket.
What was your favourite activity?
My favourite activity was flags.
What are you more confident about being at the beach?
I'm much more confident swimming at the beach now.
Hi, I'm here with Cleo. You went to the beach on Tuesday. What did you learn?
I learned beach safety and fun games to play on the beach.
Would you recommend it to other students?
Yes, I would definitely recommend the beach program to other students because it teaches you safety at the beach.
Thank you for your time.
Hi, it's me again. For our next segment, we're going to be talking to Mrs. Lamber. I'm sure you've seen her around the school. She's a really talented lady, and now we're going to find out why.
Deepu smiles as he wakes up to a beautiful, long-awaited day with clear blue skies and a gentle northerly breeze. It's Uttarayan. Kites will be flown from dawn to dusk. Deepu has been looking forward to this day as he will be flying his own kite for the first time. Let other kids be the kite runners from now on, muses Deepu with a half smile.
I'm Patrick and I'm here with Miss Lamber. I've seen you around our school working. Well, what do you do?
So I am a tutor here and I've been working here since last year, but I work here part-time. So I only come in on Wednesdays, Thursdays and Fridays. The rest of the time I'm actually a mom, a grandmom, so I do a lot of things at home. I'm also an interpreter, so I go out into the community and I interpret in Hindi, Punjabi and in Urdu, because there are lots of immigrants who don't really speak English. Other than that, I think it would be fair to call myself a writer. So whatever spare time I have, I love to write. So I'm going to just show you quickly some of the things that I've written. So this was my first published book. It's got all poetry in it. So this was a collection of poems. This one has one story and a poem. It's actually written, lots of stories written by different people in this book. Then I have this one, which is not officially published in the sense it doesn't have an ISBN number. But again, this is about Tanzania. And so it has some beautiful pictures and writing and poems about different things. This one is another book, Jay's Jenny, about our son. And it's like his biography, but in photographs. So there are photographs. And then there is writing below it. So that one. And my newest book is Let's Play, which is about traditional games played in India.
How hard is it to write a book for children?
It's just like the writing process that you do in class. So first we have to get the idea. And sometimes, I get an idea and I think this is a good idea to write about. I may start writing about it and then think, oh no, it's quite boring. Or I do some research and I think, oh, lots of people have already written books about this. So then you scrap that idea and you start with a new one. So getting the idea is a little bit tricky. And then, of course, we go through the entire process of I write and write and write and write. And then I read through it and see, does it make sense? Do I have to edit it? And most of the time, yes, I have to edit it. I have to edit it for grammar. I have to edit it for content. And then when you kind of start reading and you think, word choice, what kind of words have I chosen? Are they appropriate for the age group that I am looking at? Is my sentence structure simple enough for the kids who are going to read my book? And then once I'm kind of quite happy with it after a number of rough drafts, then the next step is looking for a publisher, which is generally the hardest part. So eventually when you do find a publisher, whether it is self-published, which means you pay for the publishing of your book, or they just love your book so much that you don't have to pay them anything. Then you start the whole process again where they read the manuscript, they edit the manuscript, they ask you to change things here and there. If you don't have an illustrator, they get you an illustrator, then you have to work with the illustrator. But you have to give them suggestions as to where do you want the illustrations, what kind of illustrations do you want, how many characters should be in the illustration. So it's a pretty complex process. So this goes on, and sometimes it takes almost a whole year to get your book published. And then when everything is ready, then they send you the final draft again after the typesetting and everything. And then if you say yes, then comes the next stage where you're writing a dedication, you're writing a foreword for the book, you're thanking all the people who've helped you, and then you're also choosing a cover page for your book. And they send you a couple of different cover pages, and you choose whatever suits you the most. So yeah, the whole publishing process takes about a year, as I said earlier.
When you were a little girl, what were some of your favorite books or authors?
Oh, when I was a little girl, I used to love Enid Blyton. And I think Enid Blyton, I believe, has written over 700 books. But I think I've read all the Five Find Outers, The Secret Seven, Mallory Towers, all the naughty books. I just loved all her books. And I must have read others, but I just don't remember. I just remember Enid Blyton because she was so good.
Can we hear a little more of your book?
Sure, what I can do is I'll actually read you a portion of one of the stories. There are 8 different stories in this book, and they're based in different parts of India. So I'm going to read to you one that is from Gujarat, and it's about kite flying. Deepu smiles as he wakes up to a beautiful, long-awaited day with clear blue skies and a gentle northerly breeze. It's Uttarayan. Kites will be flown from dawn to dusk. Deepu has been looking forward to this day as he will be flying his own kite for the first time. Let other kids be the kite runners from now on, muses Deepu with a half smile. I am going to be busy with kite flying and kite cutting. Deepu, his siblings and cousins of all ages, parents, uncles, aunts, and even the 101-year-old grandma all manage to negotiate the narrow and steep flights of stairs so that they can be on the terrace. Ladies wear colorful chaniya cholis with bandhani and mirror work and matching shoes. Deepu, like the other boys and men, is wearing the traditional kurta as the upper garment and a churno for the lower garment. The family have their kites stacked up already with the cotton thread tied to them. They have a number of spindles with really strong manja. Even if they run out of kites or manja, they can easily get more from the shops in Patang Bazaar, which will be open all night. Everyone is involved in either flying the kites, assisting the kite flyers by holding the spindle, or just shouting and cheering or blowing the peepadi. Deepu is thrilled to select his own spindle and kite. I'm ready with my kite. When will we start? Asks Deepu, getting impatient. Deepu's sister has a leaderboard to keep a tally of how many kites their family cuts. Beside the leaderboard is their first aid station with Dettol, band-aids and gloves, as people are bound to get cuts with the manja. People sway and dance to the blaring music on their CD players. There is non-stop flow of mouth-watering snacks and sweets. Families in neighboring terraces greet each other. Kemcho, Jai Shri Krishna. I'm flying my own kite today, announces Deepu to the neighbors. There is camaraderie and competition among friends and neighbors. It is an exciting and joyful day. The blue sky above is covered with millions of kites of various shapes, sizes, colors, soaring, flying, fighting, and falling. Some kites seem to do the spinning whirl before they start flying again, while others appear to nosedive. Some have short tails, while others have longer ones, fluttering, swaying, dancing gracefully while making the kites more stable and adding to their elegance. Deepu is proud to have his kite up in the skies too. He holds the spindle with both hands. It rolls at full speed, releasing the thread for the kite to fly higher and higher. Look how high my kite is flying, exclaims Deepu with excitement.
Where can we find your book?
This book, you can find it in your own library. There are two copies in your library. At the moment, Amazon, Google, and there are a couple of others websites that have an e-copy of the book. You can get the book on Kindle. Hard copies on Amazon will be available in the next few weeks, but you could download it as an ebook.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much for having me here.
Wow, that was great.
Well, it's come to the end.
Make sure you tune in next week with Natasha and Aubrey.
Bye. Bye. Well, it's come to the end.
Make sure you tune in next week to Natasha. It's so hard doing sync.